Wonderful. Welcome, mayors. I've been looking forward to this conversation for the last couple of weeks, especially in light of the national conversation, which is a lot of talk. And what I'm really, really looking forward to is to talk about some action. And there's no group of people better to talk about what it means to act than a set of incredible mayors. So I want to dive right in so that this audience can benefit from learning about what's happening in your communities. But first, I want to set the context because, as Tamar has pointed out, we have a diverse set of experiences, and we want to get a window into what some of your cities are like and what's the context of the challenge that you face. Tomorrow, Mayor Barrett, we are going to benefit from a keynote address by Matthew Desmond. And his book, Evicted, has really elevated the conversation, has put housing and issues related to poor quality housing into the conversation in a different kind of way. And it takes place in Milwaukee. And I'd love for you to give us your sense, tell us more about Milwaukee and the conditions and the challenges that Milwaukee is facing right now as we look ahead to tomorrow's discussion.
Well, I appreciate the question, and I want to thank the Center for Community Progress for hosting us. I also want to acknowledge our city treasurer, G. Spencer Coggs, who is here. Greg, and also from the city, who do a lot, they do all the work, so just so you know that. I read the book, and if you haven't read the book, it is an incredibly sobering book. Mm-hmm. It's amazingly written because it's in real time, he's in different places. But I think for any mayor, for any person who cares about society, to read that book has to give you pause as to where we are as a nation, mm-hmm. and certainly where the city of Milwaukee is right now. Just in a context, the city of Milwaukee is 600,000 people. For many years, we were Laverne and Shirley. Yeah. But Laverne and Shirley don't work there anymore. We still have Miller Brewing. Mm-hmm. But the jobs, the blue-collar jobs that were the backbone of the community in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, just like other communities, they're gone. Mm-hmm. And what's happened is you've got part of the metropolitan area that's doing extremely well. Mm-hmm. And you've got, unfortunately, a sizable group of people who are not doing well. And we could sit here for hours talking about the causes of that, but that's the reality. That's the reality mm-hmm. that we face. And what we've experienced starting back in 2008 was what I call three waves of foreclosures. The first wave came as a result of the subprime lending. Mm-hmm. The second wave came as a result of the downturn in the economy. Mm-hmm. And the third wave actually were the foreclosures that came first from the financial institutions, then from city government itself as we repossessed more homes. So we understand, and again, you look at his book, probably the part of the book that jumped out at me more than any was when he talked about how evictions for low-income African-American women are analogous to incarceration for low-income African-American males, that the insecurity and the disruption to women's lives has a devastating impact. And there's no question, again, like in many of the communities I think we have here today, you see a lot of turmoil and a lot of housing unrest, particularly among low-income people. Yeah.
Thank you for that. Mayor Taylor, East Orange, New Jersey, give us a little bit of context, but also share with us what keeps you up at night in relationship to this suite of issues that folks here have been grappling with, too.
Thank you. And I, too, want to thank the Center for Community Progress for extending this invitation to have me here today. I often say there's no I in team, so I also want to recognize our Director of Property Maintenance, Dwight Saunders. It's really his effort and work that's leading the charge in our great city. East Orange is a very densely populated city in Essex County, New Jersey. We're the second largest city in the county, right next to Newark, New Jersey. We have 65,000 people. That's about 16,000 people per square mile. Similar, back in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, East Orange had a very affluent population. After the Newark riots in the late 60s, after the construction of a major highway, Route 280, which really bisected the city, it drove a lot of business, a lot of residents out of the city. Blight, crime, issues associated with other urban areas across the country began to take hold. Population steadily decreased from about 85,000 people, let's say 20 years ago, to now we have 20,000 people in our city. In our 4 square miles in the first year of my administration, we went out into the community. We created a quality of life task force. One of the issues being vacant and abandoned properties, we counted all the properties. To date, we have identified over 1,000 vacant and or abandoned properties in our 4 square mile city. So we've worked very hard to create a vacant and abandoned property task force as an extension to address these issues, which we'll talk about later, and really focus on trying to reinvest and redevelop of the city of East Orange through a number of strategies and initiatives to drive investment back, residential, retail, and commercial. We're happy with some of the progress, but we have a lot of work to do.
So you were telling me earlier in a side conversation, what percentage of your properties are not taxable?
Great question. We have about 40% of our property that's actually non-taxable. So churches, government institutions, et cetera. And so we're working very hard to get the vacant and abandoned structures occupied. One thing I am very proud about in East Orange is that when we talk about redevelopment, we talk about gentrification, which is a term that often comes up, that's not something we're experiencing in East Orange. Most of our development, most of our investment is in vacant and abandoned property and or rehabilitation of existing structures. We have construction happening in every single ward of our city, from affordable housing to high-rise residential, market-rate residential, as well as commercial. So some of these issues we're able to address, aggressive, urban issues, progressive rather issues in our community, not to the detriment of some of the people who are there and or attracting people who need affordable places to live as well.
You pointed to an issue I hope we come back to, which is this issue, this concern about displacement, right? Even in the attempts to try to bring revitalization and how you manage that politically. I'd love to come back to that point. But Mr. Mayor, I'd love you to give us a little bit of sense of Monroe, Louisiana, and what are some of the challenges you're facing there?
Well, it's good to be here as well. Go Saints! We need a little help. But what a pleasure it is to be here today, and I want to thank the Center for inviting me as well. I too would like to introduce a city council member who is here, Juanita Wood. Somewhere here, all the way back in the back. She should be in the front. Good for her to be here. But Monroe is the birthplace of Delta Airlines, and it is the home of the University of Louisiana Monroe, and also the home of CenturyLink, which is the third largest telecommunications company in the whole United States, and also a number of other industries and businesses. And Monroe's done well over the years. And we've had progressive population over the years, and as most communities, we've had some decline. We've been as high as 60,000, we're right at 50,000 now, and some of the painkillers, if you will, for us has been flooding. You've all have heard of the flooding that occurred in Baton Rouge here recently in August, but before that, in March, we had flooding in Monroe and Northeast Louisiana. So that contributed to some of the problems we were already having, some of the blight that we've already had, because even though we're in the recovery stage, we're still having to deal with those blighted properties, unoccupied properties that have mold. There's nothing been done about it until last Tuesday when we have a chance to do so. So, of course, that brings the property value down, and Monroe is starting to grow back, but because of these challenges and 3 of our 5 city councilmatic districts is causing some issues and challenges for us. And so that's why we have to be innovative and creative in terms of how we go about trying to rebuild. Having an athletic background, we understand when you've had some good years and some challenging years, and now you're regrouping and trying to restore and get back to not only where we were, but to advance from that point.
It's great to hear you're in a recovery process and that population is coming back.
Sure.
Mayor Weaver, tell us a little bit about Flint. It's obviously been in the news quite a bit, but would love to help folks understand the context in which the water crisis is situated and how it relates to some of the vacancy and abandonment issues that others are facing too.
Okay, and I too just want to say thank you for giving me this opportunity to be here. It's so funny, I was walking around, I thought I was in Flint for a minute. I started running into so many people.
There are a lot, how many people
told
from Flint
me who all
are
was
here?
Here?
You got, yes, quite a few. You have some, a lot of constituents.
But it lets you know that we do have other things going on in the city of Flint. We're more than the water crisis. And this is something that was important previous to the water mm-hmm. crisis. But I don't know if people know that, well, you know, Flint is home of GM and UAW and mm-hmm. those kinds of things. And Flint used to be a city of 200,000 mm-hmm. or more. We're now down to 100,000 people. But when that was going on in the heyday, Flint was either first or second, the richest community mm-hmm. in the country. And people didn't know that, and that was with General Motors. Mm-hmm. But as things, you know, everybody has talked about what has led to people leaving and the economic issues, and we had those same challenges in Flint. But previous to the water issue, this was something that would have been one of our top priorities, and it still is, and you can tell by the turnout. But since we've had the water crisis, that's impacted us even more. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if people know that previous to the contamination of our water, the issue of water was really, we were paying 8 times the national average for water in the city of Flint. And many people could not afford that. So while we had already lost people and there were abandoned homes and neighborhoods that we wanted to focus on, not being able to afford water led, you know, impacted that even greater. And we had people that walked away from homes. That's what happened. And then we had the crisis with the lead contamination, which didn't help the situation at all. But one of the things that we have done as a result of that is we're looking at this as an opportunity for Flint. With this challenge, you know, becomes an opportunity. And that's what we're doing, is taking it that way. And we're looking at how do we not only rebuild infrastructure, but what are things we put in place to rebuild neighborhoods? Because now is our time, and not looking at just removing lead service lines, but how do we look at roads and sidewalks and the sewer and storm and all of those things, and putting something in place. We've talked about rebuilding Flint the right way. How do we put all of those things in place as we look at what we need to do for our neighborhoods? We weren't focusing on actually rebuilding neighborhoods for a while. We were doing demolition, but we weren't really looking at rebuilding our neighborhoods. We've done a great job as far as what we've done downtown in the city of Flint and rebuilding. And as things have come into the city of Flint, we've had more and more people that have said, we want to stay in the city. Mm-hmm. We want to stay in the city. And so now is our chance to look and see, what do we do to rebuild those neighborhoods? How do we keep people there and bring new people and look at businesses as well? So that's what we're focusing on. And so this is a great opportunity for us in the city of Flint.
I believe Congressman Kildee shared with this room that Congress had the good sense to put funding for Flint in mm-hmm. the most recent continuing resolution. So we're making a collective investment in your rebuilding as a part of that. And can you share with us a little bit about what the resources will be used for?
You know, one of the things we've been talking about is we need some money to continue with this lead service line replacement, mm-hmm. because if we can't do that, mm-hmm. then we can't really rebuild any of the other places, mm-hmm. because if you don't have clean water, nobody wants to come. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to come, and people need to feel safe and have the confidence. Mm-hmm. So we have to put in new infrastructure. That was one of the main mm-hmm. things we were fighting for. But there are also other services and supports that we need to have in place, whether it's health care, school nurses, those kinds of things. So we're looking at what are the other services and supports that the children and families in Flint deserve as a result mm-hmm. of what happened. But that's what we've been fighting mm-hmm. for, and mm-hmm. we were really, really happy to get that news yesterday mm-hmm. that things are moving forward.
Great, great. Mayor Taylor, I know you have been working hard on this set of issues and have a robust set of strategies, and love for you now to share with folks what is the sort of suite of strategies that you've been implementing in East Orange.
Sure, thank you. Similar to Mayor Weaver, you know, East Orange I experienced a water emergency when I took office mm-hmm. 3 years ago. East Orange has one of three municipally owned water utilities in the state of New Jersey, the East Orange Water Commission. It's in, but not of, the city government structure. Mm-hmm. It's a board of commissioners that I appoint, mm-hmm. confirmed by the council. The year prior to my taking office, the executive director and deputy director were indicted for falsely reporting contaminant levels in the water. Mm. One person's in jail, the other one died before he went to jail. In my efforts to overhaul that mm-hmm. system, we were met with challenges from the state of New Jersey, mm-hmm. Where they were trying to force us to sell the asset. I refused, and rather than selling it and rather than doing a long-term lease agreement with a private company, which at least in New Jersey oftentimes ends up with negative repercussions on the ratepayers, we were able to partner with a private company, Veolia mm-hmm. North America, to help us manage and build capacity mm-hmm. internally with respect to that asset. Our city council just recently approved a $20 million bond to invest in the infrastructure of that water utility to increase capacity mm-hmm. And production of safe and affordable drinking water for our community. Now, I say that to say that some of our redevelopment efforts mm-hmm. were stalled due to the inability to produce water. Mm-hmm. So we talk about trying to rehabilitate mm-hmm. the community. We talk about trying to attract investment and development. We had a dozen projects that were stalled mm-hmm. when I took office and had been stalled for a number of years because of the inability to produce water. And some of the deals that were, or arrangements that were mm-hmm. negotiated with the prior administration resulted in situations where we were paying more for water from mm-hmm. other emergency sources mm-hmm. than we were charging our customers for the water, which just dug the hole that mm-hmm. much deeper. On the vacant and abandoned properties front, our director of property maintenance, Mr. Saunders, has worked aggressively. Mm-hmm. We're leading the state. In 2004, the New Jersey legislature created a law that allowed municipalities to create a vacant and abandoned mm-hmm. properties registry, which basically allows a municipality to make banks, make landlords, families who have vacant structures register with the municipality and pay a fee. That fee starts at $500, it escalates to about $2,500. From 2004 to 14, when I took office, nothing. City of East Orange did not use that program. From 2014 through today's date, we've accumulated about $2.5 million in revenue from these mm-hmm. fees. But I always say, I don't want your money. What I want you to do is occupy the structure, rehabilitate the structure, get a tenant in there, or sell mm-hmm. it so it can be on our tax rolls. We've also been able to create a program where when we have absentee landlords and banks or investors and mm-hmm. private companies, LLCs, we've been able to utilize a law that allows us to go in after proper notice, which oftentimes takes a while, but clean up the property, cut the grass, board up the windows, and charge those fees back to the owner. Mm-hmm. We've been able to generate well over $500,000 through that program. And equally, if not more importantly, we put 12 East Orange residents mm-hmm. who were unemployed mm-hmm. to work funding through the funding in that program. So that's something that's very creative mm-hmm. That we're doing. It's very aggressive. But it's also helping to clean up our community. The challenge is staying on top of it. I'm very active in the community. I walk in the community. I was just in our fifth ward last week. We had Senator Menendez do a press conference mm-hmm. on zombie foreclosures in New Jersey. In front of a house, we had boarded up and cut the weeds mm-hmm. and everything down. 3 months later, it grew back. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to make sure we stay on top of this mm-hmm. so that we maintain our efforts and sustain our efforts in the mm-hmm. community.
Great, thank you. Mayor Mayo, so you teased us a little bit with noting that you had success this week. I had a research assistant who was following this Flight the Blight strategy unfold. Tell us a little bit more about this strategy and what it will do for Monroe.
Well, first of all, this has been a very tedious process, a long process, because it started about 2 years ago. We had another council in which they, quite frankly, they voted it down. And of course, Ms. Woods, and that's why you need to be up front to take a bow, because she ran on that Fight the Blight and she beat the incumbent. And so she's here now. And so we went through the process. We decided to put together a team of young people. We call it the Green Team, which we hired during the summer. And so they actually surveyed 10,000 properties that were of which 2,800 of them were vacant lots, and then of course you had occupied properties, but you had unoccupied properties. And so out of those, we determined that there were 600 plus that were vacant. And then you had, of those, you had about 400 that were blighted. And so they used smartphones as they went throughout the communities in those three districts. And so from that, we used that as part of our process in terms of communicating with our city council members, our new city council members, as well as the community as a whole. And I mentioned we have CenterLink there. We also have IBM that's there, Gardner Denver Thomas, a number of other companies. And so we brought the faith-based community, and we had about three community meetings. And so we got it out there. I wrote columns in the paper and so forth. Then it was time to put it before the council again on Tuesday night. And there were just maybe 2 hours worth of discussions just on that. And there were some amendments that were added. But I certainly appreciate Ms. Woods and her colleague. They voted 5-0 to pass the Fight the Blight ordinance that will put teeth in there to afford us the opportunity to be able to clean up the property. So we're going to, the next 3 months, we're going to go out and do a public relations campaign. Mm-hmm. And it will start, will be effective the 1st of January, in which we'll start doing that. But there's no question the whole community has bought into it. And quite frankly, I think the hardest part is behind us. I'm not naive because I've been in this for 15 years. But I do think the community is going to come together and help the CenterLinks, the IBMs, the Gardner Denver Thomas, and all, as well as the small businesses and mid-sized businesses continue to grow. And then to put housing back in those areas of affordable houses, as well as nice, pleasant housing in those districts such that you can have a quality of life.
And what kind of teeth does the ordinance provide?
Well, there's a starting point here where there's mm-hmm. things that obviously they have to do in cleaning mm-hmm. up. But at the very end, if they don't do all of these things, mm-hmm. their property could get seized. But mm-hmm. it's not about taking property, not about putting liens on property, but it's about coming to compliance. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're focusing on. And that's why some of the council members were very concerned mm-hmm. because of the city council member that lost was saying, here's this little old lady who's sitting in her house, that's her house is going to be taken from her, and she's going to be put out on the street, you know, mm-hmm. those type of thing. And that wasn't the case at all. But the teeth will be that they know at the very end that if they don't do everything that they're supposed to do to bring that house into compliance, that it could be seized. But quite frankly, it's not going to get to that point. Mm-hmm. Because when they know that the law has the teeth at the mm-hmm. end, I believe that they're going to do everything that they're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. And of course, we're going to, you know, bring the community in and be a part of helping them, those senior citizens that may not have relatives there. We're going to help them do as well. And I think the community will come in to help them as well. But I think that'll be something very positive that will help strengthen our community. Mm-hmm.
So Mayor Barrett, what is on your agenda? And as you share that with us, I'd love you to also talk a little bit about the context. I hadn't foreseen the way in which water was going to be a theme actually throughout the panelists in a variety of different ways. And I've been very impressed by Milwaukee's focus from an economic development strategy on hydro as a way to bring revitalization back to Milwaukee. So I'm just going to carry that theme through to you. But tell us what you are doing on blight and remediation.
Well, let me handle the water very quickly for everyone here, and you can help me with a little psychological counseling here. I have a favor to ask everyone in the room, and that is to never use the term rust belt again. Mm-hmm. And that's not a slam in manufacturing or the history of our communities, but I have this theory, and I don't want to offend anybody here, that rust belt and sun belt, those two phrases were thought up by an ad agency in Atlanta. because if I were to ask how many people like the sun, everybody's hand would go up. If I were to say how many people like rust, there'd be one wise guy who would raise his hand. I prefer, in our neck of the woods, to talk, because there's people here from the West Coast, the East Coast, the Gulf Coast, to come visit America's fresh coast. Because that's who we are, the Great Lakes. That's who we are. But in terms of we as mayors, and I listened to the other mayors, I've served in Congress, I've served in the state legislature. And in Congress, you're at 35,000 feet. At the state legislature, you're 4,000 or 5,000 feet. For us as mayors, there's not a lot of theory. Right? There's not a lot of theory. What we focus on is, all right, what works? How can we make this work? And so we are sometimes literally in the trenches. And you were asking me before about pain points. And one of my pain points was going through a foreclosed home. And this happened more than once. And seeing the posters that the little kids left on the walls. Or walking out and seeing the toys at the curb. And and asking the neighbors, you know, what can you tell me? And they said, well, it was a family and they had a couple of kids. And the kids were all crying when they were moving. So you can't forget the human element of what we're talking about. And I think the focus that we have, because we're dealing with this, what I call this these macro issues, subprime lending, economic meltdown, all these macro issues. But in reality, I think for each of us, the answers fall in the category of micro solutions. Because it's forming a relationship with a not-for-profit or a builder or a community group who's going to say, all right, I'll take four homes or I'll take six homes, or we'll buy this vacant lot and we'll put a peach orchard here. Just trying as much as we can to get families into the homes. And it's not all altruistic. For me, that's first and foremost. But again, as mayors, I call it the quadruple whammy. I want families in these homes. I want them paying taxes. I don't want them draining our police and fire resources. And of course, I don't want them driving down property values on the adjacent properties. And that's what each of us has. If there's vacant properties, and there's two or three vacant properties, boarded up houses on a block, all of a sudden the property values start going down. And so the Jones who lived there for 45 years, they've just lost sometimes tens of thousands of dollars. And they didn't do anything wrong. So I think what we try to focus on is to try to create as many partnerships as we can. And at the same time, like you're doing, create these incentives, we can call them incentives, for absentee landlords or for lending institutions. So we don't have the vacant properties. But we have challenges working with our state because they seem, they side many times with the absentee landlords or the financial institutions that I think would walk away from these properties, these zombie properties, in a minute. They would just walk away from them. And so that's the tension that we always have.
Yeah, and is that just the political influence that those institutions have then?
I think it's the disengagement. Again, I'm speaking, politics is local in our state. You've got a legislature and there's essentially nobody from the city who's in the majority. So we don't have any voices in the majority. And they pass a bill that when we try to have fines on an accelerating basis for people who do not take care of their properties, they come and whack us. And so our response is, you just passed the absentee landlord protection bill. Or you have financial institutions who are more than happy to have someone move out of a home. And the person who lives there, grandma doesn't know she still legally owns the home, but there's been no share of sale. So she's moved out of state. And so the city is sitting there cutting the grass. Grandma still legally owns it. And then the financial institution takes 9-10 months to decide whether they want to foreclose on it. And if they don't, they just walk away and the taxpayers pay for it. So that's the tension that we face. But I prefer to really focus on how do we create these partnerships. And as I say at home, I own over 1,000 people pieces of property. I don't want to own 1,000 people pieces of property. I want people to live in these in these properties.
I'm wondering, you raise an interesting issue. I wonder if others have, this has been true for you as well, in terms of building political support for your strategies. You talked about a little bit about the cost, right? The cost of inaction, the cost of that the properties have on the community. There have been some effective pieces of research. As someone from a research institution, I feel obliged to talk about the role of research in shaping the debate. But I'm curious, just what are some of those elements of success related to when you've made an argument and you've succeeded in getting other political support, be it on your councils or at the state level or at the federal level? You know, what have been some of the persuasive pieces of information or strategies that have led to successful implementation or just successful passage of a...
I think first and foremost, you just have to stay with it. We've had some setbacks as well as successes, but you talked about the vacant property registry. When this all started, we had a difficult time knowing who owned the property because there was this spider web of ownership. And so we had to get to the bottom of who owned the property so we could even know who to serve. It was that fundamental. And so we've been able to work past that. But our frustrations have come, again, more with the state and its failure to recognize the impact that this has on low-income neighborhoods.
Just to follow up on that, who helped you understand who owned the properties? Was that a partnership with another organization?
Well, that was one of the first steps we took. We passed an ordinance that allowed us
to collect that, you better
tell us who owns this property and who your local... Mm-hmm. local entity is who we serve if there are issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's similar to what we did in East Orange, utilizing the legislation that was on the books, but also strategically working with our federal representatives, state, county, and municipal. One piece is we were able to get implemented was requiring a local presence for out-of-state owners and investors so that we could serve someone. We spent countless hours searching property records, trying to find out who the fee simple owner of the property was. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes it's a vacant warehouse in Florida where no one's available to accept service, so to speak. So having a local registered agent for service is something that has helped significantly to at least start the process of establishing notice to the owner and then being able to take advantage of the ability to go in and levy fines and or to go in and clean up the property in the community has been very impactful. Mm-hmm. But what I'll also say is that in East Orange, we've developed strategic partnerships. Mm-hmm. I'll say that while we talk about holding banks accountable, with all due respect to Bank of America, we have an open invitation to come in and invest in our city. I just said a little louder, come on, clap it up. And I say that, 2 weeks ago, I was with a group, the East Orange Property Owners Association. Mm-hmm. We have a number of multifamily dwelling unit owners, apartment building owners, who have formalized a group to work with my administration to help us help them make money. We say a clean city plus a safe city equals a profitable city. So if we can help them drive up property values, everybody's happy. They get more rent, we get more taxes, it's a great community. They had one of their lending partners, Investors Bank, so you have some competition. Investors came in and talked about how Brooklyn, New York is a white hot market. And based upon the pricing getting out of whack, they're actually looking to scale back their investment in that market. East Orange is only 12 miles from Brooklyn. The second hottest market in their portfolio is East Orange, New Jersey. You have a phenomenon happening where people are moving to urban areas. And so we're embracing urbanism in East Orange. We're taking advantage, in the best sense of the word, of people being priced out of New York and other sections in Jersey, but looking for that urban existence. So we have the best environment to offer that in a suburban-like setting, but with all the amenities of an urban environment. And I think if you do that from a business and strategic political standpoint, you can create an environment that attracts investment to your community.
Mayor,
I want to mention too that in addition to getting the attention of our residents in the city of Monroe, not only this is a local issue within our city, but also it's a region issue. When you consider the fact that Monroe is the hub of Northeast Louisiana, we're the New Orleans of Northeastern Louisiana. And so we also partner with Louisiana Tech University, as well as Grambling State University. Anybody know about the band? Yeah. And so then Louisiana Delta Community College. So we've got three universities, as well as a community college or technical college. And so they know that they want Monroe to be healthy because they come to Monroe to do a lot of different things. And so we get their attention. So their professors are wanting to engage themselves into helping us to make our community better. Because when I did my State of the City address this year, one of our theme was building stronger ties with our town and gowns. And so there are a lot of different programs that we've been talking to them about. We just gave Grambling State University 2 police cars, and we've given some financial contributions to some of the programs or the others. So, so in Monroe, we have 1 university and a community college, but in our region, we've got these other resources. But the best resource is the human resource, and so bringing them all together. And then the last thing I want to say is, with the Chamber of Commerce, the more affluent folks in the community, when we did the mapping and also when we look at the census tract, we had to get their attention and let them know that some of this bleeding or the cancer was spreading over to some of their areas. And so that got their attention. So they wanted to be even more engaged. What can we do to help? Because, you know, you want your community to be whole. And so everybody's engaged in Monroe, and they're calling, wanting to know, what can we do? Banks and everything. And that's what it's all about. You have to get that human element involved.
Well, you know, I was going to say, the other thing that's been very helpful for us is when people see something going on, they want to get involved, and that helps you leverage other resources. You were talking about successes. We do have a mixed housing development that's going up right now. We have another one that's scheduled for next year, and people are hearing about that. So they're saying, okay, they are investing in this city, and it is worth staying here. We took some people on a trip just a few months ago to look at some places. I think they were down in Indianapolis, in that area, to see what they were doing there as far as new housing developments. So that's been going on. But it's also, like you talked about, as far as partnerships. And, you know, how do you do that, and how do you strengthen the ones that you have and form some new ones? And we've been working with the business community a lot, because while we have had some businesses that are saying, you know, that they're coming into the city of Flint, they've recognized that we need some other things going on as far as bringing people in a new and a revenue source. And so these companies that are coming, some of the things they're doing is offering incentives to people to live in the city. And so that's been something that we've been really, really excited about. We need more of those kinds of things to happen. Are those incentives to keep people in the city or bring people to the city? And people that were living outside, you know, come on into to Flint, and they have some things to offer them. But we were also looking at what we need to do for the neighborhoods, because we recognize that we can't have everything in one area of the city. And so as far as neighborhood development, what we've been doing is going to those, we have some neighborhoods that are stable neighborhoods. So what do we need to tear down over there to make it look better? What do we need? What sidewalks and streets do we need to fix over there to make it look better? What kinds of things do we need to beautify? But what do we do in those areas where there is an anchor? And how do we start building on those? And that's one of the things we've been looking at as well. And we had to remember, I think you were talking about it, Mayor, as far as landlords and being better partners with landlords, because we had to recognize that that's a small business, and we had to be more small business friendly. And what do we do? Because a landlord can have 4 or 5 homes on a block, which immediately, you know, increases the value. And so we've been really trying to work more with our landlords and getting them, you know, just having a better partnership with them, because they played an important part in neighborhood stabilization and revitalization, and keeping kids in neighborhoods, which helps those schools. So we've really had to reach out to the landlords and say, how do we work together better?
So I think the issue of landlords, I'm glad you elevated that. I want to come back to you, Mayor Barrett, because if anything, we learned a lot about landlords in the book Evicted, and I'm just curious what, in the Milwaukee context, where do you reach out to landlords, or what part of the conversation?
We have a training program. The city has had a training program for landlords. But again, going back to the book, it struck me, and I had never really thought about this, that the rents, and maybe everybody else in this room has thought about this, that the rents are so high in comparison to the property values. And so you've got, you don't see as great a disparity, or a difference, I should say, in rents in middle-class neighborhoods, like the neighborhood I live in, and the low-income neighborhoods. And I think what happens is the landlords build into their business model that they're going to have a higher percentage of defaults, or that people are going to be moved out or evicted quickly. And it becomes this vicious circle then, because they've built in the fact that they're going to have more people who aren't paying the higher rent, the rent period, and are evicted. Those who want to pay or can pay are going to be placed even deeper in the hole. So that's why, going back to the ordinance that we had for property owners to keep their property up to code, having, we believe that they had built right into their business model, even if we had fines that had gone up rather significantly, that was just part of their business model. And they were accepting that. Now they went to the legislature and had it changed. And so the frustration we have now is you still have the high rents, and one of our most effective tools to have them provide decent housing has been decimated, because they'll say, we'll just keep paying the fine. We'll just keep paying the fine. That's fine. And that's, you've got to find a way through the law to change their behavior as well.
I think I'm recalling that one of the women in the book pays 85% of her income in rent, right? So I think I want to come back to you, Mayor, because you mentioned something earlier about the fear of displacement, the concern you're not that far from Brooklyn. You know, I'm sure your constituents are looking at New York and the gentrification that's happened in that city and are probably concerned. Mayor Bowser wasn't able to be here on the panel today, but if we think back 10 years, 15 years to Washington, D.C., one might not have imagined the growth in population and where it is today. So, and now D.C. faces a huge housing affordability challenge and has lost a lot of the privately owned but affordable stock. So I'm curious what your thoughts are as you are in recovery modes or growing, you've lost population but are gaining population back. How do you think about this kind of framework of inclusion, or what does it mean to grow more inclusively, and what are the tensions that exist as you're both trying to attract development but also continue to support residents who've lived there?
It's a challenge. Just to take a step back, you know, I went to law school in D.C. at Howard University, I think the best law school in the country. And so I can relate back to when, you know, D.C., you know, at that time was probably the best place to be a broke law student because it was affordable and fun. Now I probably wouldn't go to law school in D.C. But fast forward to now being a mayor of an urban city, trying to redevelop the city, you know, We grapple with the term urban. Look at most major media outlets, print and or television. You know, urban is usually associated with poverty, with blight, with crime, and other negative connotations. And what we've tried to do in messaging to our community is inform and educate people that, you know, urban isn't about being black and brown. Urban isn't about being poor and or rich. Urban's about a style and a way of living. It's about proximity to transportation, mass transit, things of that nature. What we've also tried to do in educating our community and communicating with them is talk about gentrification, not just being racial, but also being economic. And any community needs to have diversity in income in order to sustain itself. Everybody wants a Starbucks, but then doesn't want to have other types of housing that Starbucks will be attracted to that community. I was approached by a resident a few weeks ago who said, Mayor, that new development isn't for me. Now, it's the same person who would say, there's no development happening, what are you doing? But now when they say it's not for me, I say, well, yes, it is, from the standpoint of you want your taxes stabilized and lowered, right? So we need some of those types of assets in our community to help us spread the wealth around and also create jobs, create other sources of retail opportunities and things like that. And so, as I mentioned earlier, with those issues being in existence, you know, our community has room to grow. You know, we're about 20,000 people plus less now than we were 30 years ago. And all of our development is happening on vacant land and or abandoned structures being rehabilitated. And so it's a great opportunity for us to create affordably priced products, market rate products, light commercial environments for jobs, and, you know, low labor from a public safety and or other services standpoint, opportunities to get revenue and ratables in our community.
You just made me think about something because, you know.
It's Howard University, baby.
Okay, wait a minute. I went to Tougaloo. But
When I was thinking about what you talked about as far as General Motors and mm-hmm. Flint, and when General Motors left, I don't think Flint was ready for that because we weren't mm-hmm. diversified. And Flint was when I was growing up, almost everybody in the city of Flint had a car. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't, you knew somebody that did. Mm-hmm. So transportation was never an issue. And that was one of the things we didn't do very well, was making it a city where mm-hmm. there are other ways to get around. And I never thought I'd be saying today that transportation has become an issue in the city of Flint. And so as we look at mm-hmm. rebuilding and look at what we need to do for neighborhoods, that's one of the things that we're focusing mm-hmm. on, is how do we make this I'm not sure what the term is, but a walking community, mm-hmm. or make it easier for people mm-hmm. to get around. And we had not done that mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm. And so we've got to look at what we do, because we know that transportation mm-hmm. is an issue. How do we enhance and increase our public mm-hmm. transportation? But what do we do to make it easy to get around the city of Flint? Mm-hmm. And so we know we have to do that if we want to rebuild. And as we look at what we have to put in our neighborhoods and even our downtown area, what do we have to mm-hmm. do to make it more access friendly for people getting here and there? Mm-hmm. And so that's one of the things mm-hmm. we're looking at as we have this opportunity to yeah. not only put in lead service lines, but mm-hmm. rebuild our city.
Well, you all have very full agendas, and I'm thinking about the fact that we will have a new president in a little more than 30 days. what's the number one priority on your agenda to take to a new administration? What do you want them to do that would help you and your cities?
I'm willing to work with whoever she is. All right. I think we probably all would agree in urban policy, dealing with cities that have older infrastructure, mm-hmm. that's something that's real to all of us. And for all of us, we're not, if I can speak for all of us, we're not the glamour cities, mm-hmm. If I may. I'm not offending anybody. and so even for gentrification, for example, mm-hmm. In my neck of the woods, we have, unfortunately, the second highest concentration of low-income people mm-hmm. of any metropolitan area in the country. In other words, San Antonio yeah. has 73% of its low-income people in the core city, Milwaukee's second at 72%. Mm-hmm. And for years, we had battles with the suburbs over low-income housing or affordable housing or working housing. Mm-hmm. And it got to the point where I thought, well, if you're not going to take some of our poor people, well, then we'll take some of your rich people and try to achieve mm-hmm. economic diversity mm-hmm. by having that and doing it in a way that doesn't displace people. Mm-hmm. So we were able to do it in warehouse districts mm-hmm. and things like that. But mm-hmm. to your question about the next administration, I think that when you look at what's going on in this nation right now in urban areas, police-community relations, concentration of poverty, there has to be a recognition that there are some people who in the globalization of our economy have been left behind. And we as a society have to make a decision what we're going to do about that. And so, again, getting back to the practical, that's why there's times when we'll do deconstruction of homes rather than demolition of homes, because we can put people from the neighborhood to work. And it's how do you put people from the neighborhood to work? And I think that's what I'm looking for, mm-hmm. is I've got a large pool of people who are low income and don't have a lot of education, but they still have families, mm-hmm. and human dignity comes into play here.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you.
I think anytime that you have natural disasters, there are opportunities. And right now, there are a lot of different projects that we've worked on, City of Monroe, both local, state, and federal, when we lobby the federal government for different things. Mm-hmm. But it's something about when you have that natural disaster, like Hurricane Katrina, in which you see New Orleans is not back the way it was. Well, that's a good thing in one sense, because you had a lot of blight there, and there are some areas being redeveloped as we speak. But the spotlight is on that particular city, town, or village. Now, because of our recovery effort, because of the flooding that we experienced in March and also Baton Rouge in August, the attention is on Louisiana with all of the inches of rain that we realized. And so we have President Obama's attention, and we have her attention too when she's elected. But also we have the governor's attention, John Bel Edwards, I was fortunate to be a co-chair on his transition team, and so they know where Monroe is. You know, he's there and he's advocating for Monroe. So there are a lot of things that you can talk about, but when the spotlight is on you because of those natural disasters, there's plenty of opportunities in housing, transportation, you name it. You know, so those are things that we'll look to continue to work on, because that's going to help build our community back.
Well, I have to say that we're in year three in Flint that we can't drink our water. We're in our third year and we're still on bottled and filtered water. And while this wasn't a natural disaster, it's a disaster nonetheless. And this should not be that we don't have clean, affordable water in the city of Flint. So I would say that I have to talk about, and what I'm looking for is it has to be around infrastructure, investment and maintenance of infrastructure, and looking at water quality standards. Because if you don't have clean water, people aren't going to stay. You know, we've already had people that are sick. We've already had people die from Legionnaires. So people won't stay. Neighborhoods will go down. Schools will continue to close. Businesses will leave. And new ones will not come. And so that has to be the focus of what I'm going to be talking with Hillary Clinton about when she gets in office. Because, I mean, if we don't have that, you know, all of those other things that we've talked about as far as economic development and building neighborhoods and everything else we need to have a thriving city, it won't happen if we don't have clean, affordable water in Flint.
But I do think, again, infrastructure is key, you know, not just water. You know, in a community like East Orange, an older urban community, our schools are old. So while the supply of water might be safe and healthy pursuant to DEP regulations, the pipes that it travels through, you know, may not be. Fortunately, they are now, but in 10 years, they may not be. So we have to look at that. Another issue that's of concern is a public safety, but also from a national issue with respect to terrorism. My understanding is from conversations with Congressman Donald Payne Jr. is that, you know, the northeastern part of our country, where New Jersey is one of the top five terror targets in our country. And so being able to focus on the issues for first responders and those infrastructure needs, looking at a lot of the federal grants that are available for public safety, I always say they're usually for people or stuff that when the grant expires, you still have to maintain those salaries. But there are very few funds available for infrastructure. Our newest firehouse is probably 70 years old in East Orange. And so that is a public safety issue that doesn't only help local safety, but also regional when you get into a terror and or other emergency situations. And I think those are necessary, critical issues where funding has to be trickled down to the local area. And one last issue is roads, bridges, and tunnels. Again, you know, New York, New Jersey, our governor in New Jersey has suspended work on the Transportation Trust Fund. So not only do you not have critical infrastructure projects going forward, you have small businesses, construction companies, being put out of work and out of business because of a lack of funding at the state and federal level to make sure that our communities, our roads, our bridges are passable and safe and not crumbling.
Great. You all have a very robust agenda to take to the next president. So we're going to take questions in just a minute. I'm going to ask one last round robin, but then we look forward to audience participation. So thinking about your peers, you all are leaders on addressing blight in your communities. And thinking about your peers, what is the one piece of advice you would give to them about where to start if they want to start to tackle issues related to blight? And I'll go down this way now.
Dwight, stand up. So, that is Dwight Saunders. He is a former councilman in the city of East Orange. He is a member of my administration, director of property maintenance. He affectionately goes by the name within the residential landlord community of Gunsmoke. So you get yourself someone like him who's going to aggressively but fairly enforce the laws and the ordinances in our community.
All right.
And that helps kind of whip people into shape. So thank you, Dwight.
All right, get it, Dwight.
Well, you have to have those things whipped into shape. You're absolutely right. But we also had to, one of the things we did was, it was a grassroots kind of thing because the people were involved. And the people were the ones that were saying, no, this is our city, and we don't like how it looks. We're going to be active and strong and make sure we're doing our part. And so it was encouraging them. But, you know, I have to say we have a great Michigan delegation that was working hard to get us some funding for Blight. And can't be scared to ask for what you need and just put it out there and really holding some of the businesses accountable and letting them know that they play a role in what's going on. And so that's what we've done, creating those partnerships and talking with them and getting them to be much more involved in what's going on in these cities.
Great.
Well, the first thing I did when I became mayor in 2001 was hire a public relations person. And of course, that is so valuable because you need someone to spin out of some of the things that spun into by some of the public, especially those that got different motivations. And that's all he does. And I'm sure, Mayor, I'm sure most of you probably have a public relations person, but if you don't, we need to. And then to craft a message for the public and whatever that you're doing, because you need to keep it out there every single day, because things change so fast. And so when things come up, that public relations person can stay on top of it, and you can stay on message and what you're trying to do, because we waste a lot of time trying to spin out of some things that come up when we're trying to do things that's going to help the community. So all the things that we've talked about in messaging, if it's not out there consistently, it's going to be very, very difficult. I have a journalistic background. My diploma was in business administration, but I was a former point guard. It took me 40 years to get like this. I was also a quarterback in high school, so I do understand to be methodical, as I mentioned earlier, innovative and creative in terms of putting together a plan and knowing that we can't do everything at one time. But we all have, no matter how depressed that you think that certain areas are, we all have positives and strengths in the community. And we have to build on those strengths and work on those challenges. But when you're building on those strengths, some of the challenges will get taken care of.
Great, so build on the assets.
And just building off what Mayor Mayo was saying, I'd say persistence and creativity as well. We created a position in my office to deal with this issue, but worked very closely with our city attorney, very, very closely with our Department of Neighborhood Services, which is our building inspector. And you just stay at it because you've got landlords, you've got institutions that are looking for ways to work around you and outsmart you, and you have to be as persistent and as creative to do what you can, and then to make sure you're doing everything you can to communicate that to community groups and others who live in the neighborhood. So there's frustration in the low-income neighborhoods, at least in my city, there's a lot of frustration. And you have to be truthful with people, but also have them understand that you really are trying to help them. And that's not always easy to do, again, because the distrust is there.
Great, what a terrific set of advice. So please, where do we have? We have a runner with a microphone, but we need hands of anybody who wants to ask a question. Okay, we have a question up here and a question, I think, back. Oh, is the mic back there?
Yes.
Okay, okay, great. Go ahead.
I'm Julie Seward with the Funders Network for Smart Growth and Livable Communities, and I have two questions. One is there any real difference between restoration strategies in small and large places, other than scale and resources? Or is there something that really is intrinsically different depending on the size of a place? And the second question I have you been successful in hinging some of your strategies into regional solutions? And that is getting some of the regional players to be a part of solutions for your cities.
Great. Okay, so there are two questions there. Let's just take the first question first, which is we have a mixture of size. And I guess the question is there something different between, let's say, a Milwaukee or a Flint or Monroe or an East Orange, or there are some similarities? Who wants to jump in on that?
If I may, I don't know. I've been mayor for 2.5 years, so I haven't been here long enough to kind of test the market in comparison to other communities. I will say we do work collaboratively with our neighbors, mm-hmm. The mayors of Newark, Irvington, Orange, mm-hmm. all urban communities mm-hmm. In Essex County. But what I'll also say, you know, East Orange, second largest community or city in our county, I often say that we are large enough to be relevant from a political standpoint. You know, we're 99.9% Democratic, so that's important next year in our gubernatorial race. Mm-hmm. But we're small enough to be manageable. Mm-hmm. And so some of our initiatives that affect a corner or a block, mm-hmm. you know, really does affect, you know, one quarter of our city. Mm-hmm. Whereas you have a larger city geographically, it might be harder to see the kind of ripple in the pond, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So I think that the issues and programs that we're doing can be scaled up to other communities, mm-hmm. But I think that the immediate tangible benefit will be realized mm-hmm. In a smaller geographic area like East Orange.
Right, you know, and I would have to echo that. I'm sure there's some similarities, but that's what I would say mm-hmm. about Flint. We're a little bit larger than you were, 100,000, but one of the good things we've told people is we're small enough where you can see some immediate impact. So mm-hmm. once something happens, everybody knows it's happened. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You don't have to drive around and look for it. People recognize it right away. And so we get that effect probably mm-hmm. quicker just because people see it. And that's what I said has been very helpful in us to leveraging other people. And because, you know, just with what's been going on in Flint, that's something that has really helped us emotionally mm-hmm. To say, oh, wow, look at what's going on in our city, mm-hmm. even with all of these other things going on. So that's I guess that's one of the benefits mm-hmm. of being smaller is you do get to see, you know, an immediate impact. But sometimes when you're larger, I guess it's easier to get people there, too. I don't know.
So Milwaukee, how would you?
Well, I would say internally, my experience has always been working with other mayors that yeah. it's a matter of scale, that we, mm-hmm. They're very comparable, that mm-hmm. the size of the city isn't as relevant because we all have similar issues, and you might have a different size staff that works with it, mm-hmm. but they're very much analogous to each other. For us, it is... We don't have as many partners, again, because we are the home of the concentration of poverty. So mm-hmm. 45 minutes away, we'll have Racine and Kenosha, we'll have Beloit.
Yep.
But in our metropolitan area proper, the poverty has been located in the city. And so the challenge we face is, oh, that's your problem. Mm-hmm. You have a problem. And that's the thing that I get emotional and yeah. hot under the collar mm-hmm. about. Because whether it's intentional or unintentional, whether it's government-driven or private sector-driven, the reality is that the poverty has been hyper-sick.
Yeah.
Located in my city.
So the second part of that question was around regional solutions. Do you have any hope or do you see a glimmer of light out there for a regional solution?
You always, in these jobs, you have to be filled with hope.
Right.
Right. You, seriously, you have to be filled with hope mm-hmm. and recognize. And we had a rough weekend this summer where we had some civil disturbances, and I'm trying to make the best out of that where I'm getting businesses to say, look, you don't want your colleagues around the nation to be calling you saying, what's going on in Milwaukee? We're in this together. This is not altruism, and trying to get that message across. So I'm trying to deliver that message mm-hmm. to my business community right now in real time.
Mm-hmm. Any other regional solutions or ways in which your neighboring cities or the county or others have helped to address some of the challenges?
Well, I'll mention again, I'm part of a couple of different economic development organizations mm-hmm. and because Monroe is the hub of Northeast Louisiana, which consists of about a quarter of a million people, but we're the marketing center for about 500,000 because we also have Southern Arkansas and Western Mississippi who actually come to Monroe because we're the hub and we're mm-hmm. within close proximity. So you know, I've been to El Dorado, Arkansas. I've spoken to some groups there, been to Natchez as well as Vicksburg, as well as some of the other areas mm-hmm. within our region. And so that is very important because they feel like if they're smaller communities, they feel like, well, the mayor of Monroe, who they see as a Baltimore or mm-hmm. Houston, you know, he's coming and talk to little old us, so mm-hmm. to speak. And so they're more engaged in coming to help. They spend their dollars. I've known other mayors that have spent their honeymoons, mm-hmm. you know, in Monroe. But I didn't have a chance to address the first part. I think everything is relative. When I go to the different conventions and talk to the mayors, if I talk to the mayor of Houston, he's got the same challenges that I have in Monroe, but they're just much on a larger scale. And so resources, that is a lot of times, that is the difference. He's got more resources than me, but we have to put together a similar type strategy. He may have a larger transit system. I've got a transit system, but it's much smaller. But we all have the same type of challenges. But I can learn, and I have learned. We're 50,000, but I've gotten good ideas from mayors that represented only 200, 1,000, because there are a lot of good ideas out there.
Great. There was a question up front. We have one microphone, so it takes a little bit of time to run the room. The question is right up here in the front table. Here it comes. Is there another question after this one? Anybody, just so we can plan the microphone?
Thank you. David Bowers with Enterprise Community Partners. Mayor Taylor, go HU. Wanted to ask, are any of the mayors doing anything in terms of trying to put local dollars, local city dollars, into the efforts around vacant and abandons and potentially putting them in land trust or land banks? And or have you had any success getting private philanthropic dollars into the mix to help you with your efforts around this, particularly thinking in terms of the gentrification issue, right? Over time, you don't want those, that could be stock you wish you had, so to speak.
Well, one of our initiatives, the Vacant and Abandoned Properties Program and Registry, we did start it with a $50,000 in startup funds from the municipal budget. Again, we have regenerated those monies through the fines and or assessment fees. I referenced earlier about $2.5 million, which goes into our general fund. So we're able to kind of make it a self-perpetuating type of program that can be repurposed for that. And one of the other things I'll say is, you know, in East Orange in particular, we are unique in some respects. We have our own water utility that, although it was, you know, mismanaged in the past, we look at that as an opportunity to create recurring revenue. You know, we have a golf course. East Orange has one of three or four municipally owned golf courses in the entire state of New Jersey. That was losing $250,000 a year when I took office. Versus, rather than sell it, which is what the state was trying to force me to do, because they said, hey, you're a broke city. Why do you have a luxury asset like a golf course? And I said, have you been there? It ain't that luxurious. So we closed it for a year. We got a bond, we reinvested in it. Long story short, it's making so much money we can't count it right now. And so as an urban municipality, when you get a lot of pressure from your suburban counterparts, I'm sure in every state, that all the resources are being dumped into you know, the urban communities, whether it be education, whether it be jobs, whether it be crime, if you can show some qualitative and quantitative successes that are measurable, I think it takes some of that pressure off you politically, but economically. You know, we were in a situation where we had a $10 million budget deficit. Now, 2.5 years later, we're looking at a $12 million fund balance, in part based upon these recurring revenues we've been able to tap into, both legislatively with vacant and abandoned properties and from a business standpoint with the assets that we have.
Great. Others who want to address that question?
In Milwaukee, I can tell you, in 2000, just to give you a perspective, in 2007, we foreclosed through our tax foreclosure process 78 homes, somewhere in that neighborhood, and so we were able to sell most of them. Now, today, I have well over 1,000 pieces of property in our inventory. And so that'll just give you the scale of how much it's changed. So our budget was very small then to deal with it. And over the last 3 years, we've put close to $35 million in. This year, I think my budget, I think it's close to $13 million that we put in. Some of that is cash, some of it is bonding. For example, we've got a program, we've got demolition dollars that we put in, a couple million dollars for demolition. That's now has been matched by the state. We have a program that we just raised the budget $500,000 to $800,000 for code compliance loans. Grandma's in the house. She's lived there 17 years because our average age is 59, 61 years old. They've been in the house 17 years, but the house has code violations. We'll lend them the money to fix that house, and then we'll get the repayment when they sell the house. There's another program where in neighborhoods where they're still underwater, we don't want to have them walk away from the home. So based on the county median income, we have forgivable loans and part forgivable loans for exterior improvements to the property as well. So in a wide range of areas, this is has become a major area of city government for the city of Milwaukee.
Anybody else?
I created an economic development fund several years ago, and the balance has been as high as $12 million that we've used for a number of different things, and as low as probably what it is now, maybe a couple of million. And so we enter into projects such as these to help with blight. But in addition to that, we also established a neighborhood stabilization program in which we have partnered with a company called, a nonprofit called Rays of Sunshine. And they have gotten some of this blighted property and cleaned it up. And now they've put nice homes on there, and people are now living there with a better quality of life. But in addition to that, we've partnered with Habitat for Humanity. And so a lot of that has been great as well. So we all have talked about forming partnerships with a number of different areas or nonprofits. So I think a lot of times we get lost in when we're thinking about federal dollars and that type of thing, we forget about what we already have there that can help assist us in revitalization.
And I would have to say we have those partnerships as well, but it's been a little bit different in Flint, because one of the things that's separated us from some of the other cities is in Flint, we've been under an emergency manager for 6 years. And that was not only Flint, but Detroit, Pontiac, Benton Harbor, a lot of the urban areas in the state of Michigan. And so when being under an emergency manager, our assets were sold. Mm-hmm. You know, so we don't have the golf courses. We didn't have our garbage trucks. Mm-hmm. Golf trucks, garbage, snow removal services. Mm. In fact, we used to sell water in the city of Flint, and they sold our pipeline. So a lot of those assets that we used to have to be able to take care of ourselves and generate revenue are gone. Even if you look at how they came into City Hall and wiped out staff, we were operating with a skeleton crew. We didn't have economic development in City Hall anymore. So one of the things we've been doing is really trying to rebuild those kinds of things and put those things back in place so we can do more of the things that the other mayors have been talking about. But I also want to go back to the question that was even before when you were asking what we were doing. And it was, I know we reached out and we've been partnering not only with the Flint and Genesee Chamber of Commerce, we had Grand Rapids, Detroit, and the Michigan Chamber of Commerce come through and look at Flint, because we have so much vacant land and there are we do have things to offer. And so it was partnering with them and taking them around and showing them our city and saying, okay, what are some things you all are willing to do to bring here to the city of Flint? And how do we make that happen? We've been setting up tours for people from around the state to come and see what's going on in Flint and say, yes, they're going to make a commitment to invest and do some more things in our city.
Great. We have time for one more question, if there's another question.
Hello, Adeline Hall from the City of Cincinnati. I have a question for Mayor Barrett. After reading the book Evicted, Matthew Desmond lists a series of suggestions to deal with the affordable housing crisis, one of which being to expand the housing voucher program. And I wonder from an administrative role, if you think that the series of suggestions he gave could be implemented in your city, and if you're planning to implement any of them.
What we've done is we've assembled a group, and Greg has been part of that as well, from the city attorney's office. We've sat down and discussed ways we can address it. So I'm interested. I have not met Mr. Desmond yet. I'm looking forward to meeting him tomorrow and getting a sense from him as well. But obviously, we want to see what we think is going to work in our neck of the woods.
Mm-hmm. Great. I think this recommendation he made that you alluded to, Mr. Mayor, which is the housing affordability challenges that very low-income people face, that we, and I argue for this personally, that we just need to expand federal rental assistance so that we can be enabling people of extremely low incomes to be able to afford the housing that they're living
in. And again, in our city, our public housing, we're actually proud of the public housing we have in our city, and the Section 8 program is obviously an important component of that.
Yeah.
And having affordable, decent housing is something that I think, again, going back to your question, what we want to see from the next president, that would certainly be part of that as well.
Great. Terrific. Well, then, thank you so much for such a great conversation.